Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. With the blessings of Lord Dhanvantari and with the blessings of Shri Guru Mahanta Swamiji, let us start today's program. A very good morning, one and all. Myself, Dr. Vishwaradhya Hiremath, Assistant Professor, Department of Kaumarabhritya, SVM Ayurveda Medical College, Ilkal, welcomes you all for Kumarabharana 2020 National Webinar Series. Today, we have with us an eminent speaker, resource person, Dr. Hemalata N. Potti. Madam, it's my pleasure to introduce you, madam, on this occasion. Madam completed graduation from Government Ayurveda College, Tripuranitra, and post graduation from IPGT RA, Gujarat Ayurveda University, Jamnagar. Madam has over 23 years of professional experience in various walks of Ayurveda industry, clinical practice, research, and academics. Madam started her career as a junior physician in Aryavaidya Chikitsalayam and Research Institute in 1996. Then she moved on to the post of Chief Medical Officer at AVP Anugraha Hospital, Kottayam, and Madam worked as the principal research scientist in the Department of Drug Discovery and Development in Reliance Life Sciences, heading the section of phytochemistry for 4 years. Later, she joined Amrita School of Ayurveda as faculty of Kaumarabhritiyam. She has served as the founder director of International Ayurveda Foundation, a London-based NGO promoting the messages of Ayurveda globally. She was also a visiting faculty of Rosenberg's European Academy of Ayurveda, conducting seminars and practical sessions in Ayurveda focusing on Kaumarabhritiyam. She has been an integral part of organizing committee of various national and international seminars inside and outside Kerala. The latest being the coordinator for International Ayush Conclave 2019 at Trivandrum. She was the coordinator for the prestigious Global Ayurveda Festival, Kerala. Also, Madam has been invited as a speaker in various national and international seminars and conferences. Presently, Madam is working as Professor and Head Department of Kaumarabhritiya, Amrita School of Ayurveda, Amritapuri, Kollam, Kerala. With this brief introduction, I hand over Madam to deliver today's lecture. Over to you, Madam.
Thank you very much, Dr. Hiremath. It's actually a pleasure to have all your students with us here for the seminar. And I really appreciate the efforts you are taking to organize so much of seminars and series to enlighten the students from the faculties over various parts of the country. Congratulations to you. And thank you very much for the opportunity to address your students.
Thank you, madam.
Now, a very warm welcome to all dear students and participants of this seminar. I know that being Ganesh Chaturthi, it's a little too much for me to ask all of you to have undivided attention for a span of about 1 hour and a half. Anyway, I think it's a very good day to begin with the blessings of Lord Ganesh. So I first of all wish all of you a very happy Ganesh Chaturthi. So friends, I hope all of you are ready. Let's start with the presentation. We are now talking about congenital heart diseases in children. Like many other chronic diseases which require emergency management at various stages, congenital heart diseases in children is also a little wary topic for Ayurvedic people. Again, when the students ask me about, ma'am, why do we learn about congenital heart diseases in laboratory when we are not able to manage or treat the patients, I always tell them, each and every disease will have a specific target of management when we approach the patient. For example, suppose you are having a CP patient, okay? So you treat the CP patient not to cure them, is it? Do you promise the parents of the relatives of the patient that, okay, you bring the patient to us, we'll cure them, they'll be able to lead a normal life? No. So each and every disease, when we are approaching it, has to have a treatment goal, which is depending on two factors. First of all, it is the disease itself, and second, the patient. Like we say, purusham purusham viksha, the prognosis, the method of the approach, the management strategies all differ from person to person, maybe symptomatically and also with the resources, right? So with this introduction, let me tell you all the aspirants of Ayurveda, that the basic aim in understanding congenital heart disease is not to cure the patient as such, but proper and timely diagnosis is the key to understanding congenital heart diseases in children. Okay, as we go on with the presentation, we'll understand that there are many congenital heart diseases which are silent, which will not have any kind of symptoms. So in such cases, the patient may present with other symptoms like general growth failure or recurrent infections, especially upper respiratory infections, because of the improper coordination between the heart and the lung. The patient will be having oxygen insufficiency in many cases, and as a result, there will be problems of growth and development also. So such symptoms may present in congenital heart disease, which makes it essential for us to understand the underlying cause and to properly and timely diagnose whether the patient who presents with a recurrent respiratory symptom or a growth failure has an underlying congenital heart disease, especially in toddlers and in young children. We will have to have a thorough understanding, thorough examination of these diseases to diagnose and refer, or in cases of asymptomatic cases, manage. Okay, so let's get into the concept. Like many other diseases, there is no direct reference to Sahaja Hrudrogas in Ayurveda, even though scattered references are available on Sahaja Vyadhis. Especially, they are aiming at understanding these Sahaja Vyadhis on a perspective to prevent them. The Sahaja Vyadhis, in most cases, can be congenital anomalies, and these anomalies can be prevented by following very strict Garbhinicharyas, Ritumaticharya, and the observance of desired Maithuna Vidhi also, as advised in classical texts. This is the whole purpose of understanding Sahaja Rogas is beyond the management. We'll have to focus on strategies for prevention by adopting proper methods of what we call the quality progeny or an offspring, right from the thought of conception. Samanya Nidana of Sahaja Vyadhis. Charakacharya and Charitasthana says that Bija Atma Karma Ashaya Kala Dosheir Madhustatha Ahara Vihara Dosheir Kurvanti Dosha Vividhani Dushta Samsthana Varna Indriya Vairudhani. So the reason for samsthana, varna, indriya, vaikrutas in an offspring can be either a bija dosha. We learned quite a lot even in Prasuti Tantra. We learned bija dushti and their chikilsas. So the first thing has to be quality of the bija. Can be male and female bija. Atma karma dosha. Atma karma dosha is, we can point it to various misdeeds or non-observance of proper rituals or routines of life. Ashaya dosha, the proper health of the uterus. Basically, that is very important, especially in today's environment when there is just a moment, please. ഞാനൊരു അല്ലല്ലോ ഞാനൊരു വെബിനാറിലാണ് എന്നൊരു ആ ഒരു മണി കഴിഞ്ഞിട്ട് വിളിക്കുമോ ആ ശരി ശരി ആ സോറി സോ ആശയ ദോഷ ലൈക്ക് ദ ക്വാളിറ്റി ഓഫ് വൂം ഓർ ദ യൂട്രസ് ഇസ് വെരി ഇമ്പോർട്ടൻറ്റ് വിത്ത് മിഥ്യാചാരാസ് ആൻഡ് വിഹാരാസ് ഫൈൻഡിങ് മോർ സ്പേസ് ഇൻ ടുഡേയ്സ് യങ് women, it is very, very important that this point has to be kept in mind. Kala dosha, it is like, you know, from the right from the moment of conception, there are the union of the sperm and the egg has to be that specifically timed to ensure the quality of the bija. And madhu ahara and vihara, even the environmental etiological factors, quite a lot of them are pointing to the incongenial ahara and vihara of the mother. So basically, once you're analyzing the nidanas, as told in Ayurveda, we can understand that basically the genetic and environmental causes, which are later explored by the modern medicine experts, are covered in the concept of sahaja vyadhis, especially the nidanas, pertaining to bija dosha, ashaya dosha, and also ahara viharas. So these are the points which have to be taken in mind while we are advising the patients, especially when there is incidence of sahaja vyadhis in the family. While taking the family history, you will have to counsel the patients and the parents, basically the parents and relatives, accordingly. That's the first strategy of prevention. Specifically coming to the danas of hridayajanya vigaras or congenital heart diseases. Again, Acharya Charaka says about the bija dushti. Yasya hyangavayavasya bija bhago abhitapto bhavati tasya tasya angavayavasya vikrutirupajayane na upajayate cha na anupadapat. So which means the bija bhaga avayava, which denotes the chromosomes and the genes. When this gets affected, when this gets dushta, there will be vikruti or defects in the corresponding parts that is determined by the specific chromosomes and genes. This is a clear-cut direct reference to various kinds of genetic defects and disorders. Which are congenital, also many of them are associated with like Marfan syndrome, Down syndrome, and all. We know that they are associated with congenital heart diseases, isn't it? So this point of bija dushti refers to such kind of diseases where the bija dushti of the chromosomal or the genetic defects lead to specific congenital disease. In Arthava dushti specifically, Sharira Acharya says that Hridayam is Madhraja Bhava, isn't it? So they say that Madhrajascha Ayam Garbha Tadida Tvakcha Lohidamcha Mamsancha Medascha Nathischa Hridayam Cha. So Hridayam is Madhraja, and definitely so the Arthava Dushti plays a very important part in causing congenital heart disease. The main dhatu in Hriday Vikaras definitely is Sleshma Dosha and Shonita Khadu. Shonita Kapprasada Jamkradayam Susruta refers. So basically in CHD, when you assess the whole situation Ayurvedically, we had to focus on the predominance of Rekta Dhatu and Sleshma Dosha. Even though in Hriday Vikaras, when we assess congenital diseases specifically, there is not much of a Sleshmaja Bhava. It's more of like, you know, Kapha Pittaja in nature. And most of the congenital diseases, they present the symptoms also in that aspect. So we can understand that the disease, the dosha to focus is Kapha, and the Dhatu to focus is Rekta in management of congenital heart diseases. Again, like we have discussed, the Garbhashaya Drushti, the effect of Kala. Kala is like, you know, the Bija Samyoga Kala. Mainly, and the Ahara Viharas of mother all have a role in causing congenital heart disease. And while talking about the effects of all these things, it all points to the fact that proper adherence to the various charyas, right from Ritumati Charya, and there are a lot of do's and don'ts which have been advised by Acharyas even during Maithuna, and also the time for best progeny to conceive, and also Garbhini Charya once the conception has happened, and also proper adherence to the Aharas and Viharas of the mother after conception. All these factors have to be properly planned in a pregnancy for avoiding any kinds of congenital vikaras. Specifically, in this context, we are talking about congenital heart diseases. Most of the symptoms of congenital heart diseases are focusing to Kapha, Pitta, Hridrogas. Like we can say Shwasa Avarodha, Klamam, Tandra, Staimityam. Again, Hridaya Ardravada, Hridaya Dravada and Hridaya Shunyata are also seen in certain congenital heart diseases. Whereas Aruchi, Jwara, Alpanidra, Moham, all these symptoms are seen in patients with congenital disease, heart diseases at various stages in various diseases. So these symptoms, which are corresponding to Kapha, Pittaja, Hridroga, can stay close to the concept of CHDs in Ayurvedic concepts. Now, the fate of patients with CHD. The congenital heart diseases can be in a quite wide range in their prognosis. Right from very mild defects which leave the patient unnoticed even till adulthood. There can be very fatal diseases which require immediate attention at the time of birth. So the prognosis largely depends on the size of the defect and also the gravity of the defect. So thus, a patient born with CHD can either have it yapya, that is managed with the disease, with proper management techniques, or it can be sukhasathya or cured. Many diseases like patent ductus arteriosus and all, if mild, and even ASDs, most of the mild ASD cases are not seen with any symptoms. So the symptoms on course of time, the repair happens naturally by the first couple of years, and within the toddler period, mostly minor defects get self-limited and the problems cease to exist. And finally, the most fatal defects, there can be many a congenital heart disease which ultimately leads to the mortality of the child. Being Ayurvedic physicians, we have to focus on the first two types where the patient manages post-surgery and also without surgery with medications to relieve the symptoms, basically the symptoms of palpitation, breathlessness, what we manifest as respiratory symptoms, and also the patients who doesn't have any symptom. But you might have heard quite a lot of congenital heart disease patients say that at the moment there is no problem, but when the child grows up, at the time of strenuous exercises or when the patient undergo anesthesia, general anesthesia, before some surgeries and all, there has to be the diagnosis have to be kept in mind. So in such condition, to strengthen the hridaya as an avayava, the heart muscles, or to enhance the self-healing, and in patients who are continuing post-surgery or after the medication, to improve the quality of life, these are the areas where we Ayurvedic physicians can focus and interfere, rather than going directly into these congenital defects, which are mostly surgically managed, where we don't have any role at all. Let us focus more in the management aspect for milder forms of CHDs, which are asymptomatic or which later may create complication. And also the most important thing to bear in mind with a patient with congenital heart disease is, even though the symptoms are minor or absent, there will be improper oxygen, improper oxygenation of that. So oxygen insufficiency may be there, and also there will be failure to thrive. So let's focus on such symptoms from the very small age to cope up better with the situation of the diseases, which can be self-limiting or vanish on their own. Let us come to the disease part, the understanding of the disease. Understanding of congenital heart disease is not possible without understanding two things. One is the structure of the heart. Second thing, the circulation of blood. So first let us focus on the structural aspect. You all have studied the structure of the heart with its chambers and the vessels. The most important, the left and the right chambers, where the left chamber, the ventricle and the atrium containing oxygenated blood, whereas the right side containing deoxygenated or the venous blood. I don't take much time in understanding the anatomy of the heart, which you already know. So let us get into the disease. Statistics say that one child among 125 labors in India is affected by some form of congenital heart disease. There is no gender differences, both male and female. Generally speaking, there are specific CHDs where specific male or female children are more prone. But generally speaking, in CHDs, both genders are equally affected. But we see in certain environmental conditions, like in the parents who are living in high altitude, the incidence of patent ductus arteriosus and also atrial septal defects are seen a little higher than the other living in the lower altitude. And also certain conditions like maternal infections. We all learn about the complications of torch infections in during pregnancy, isn't it? So the maternal infections, especially rubellar infection, is found to be associated with an increased incidence in patent ductus arteriosus and also pulmonary valve or pulmonary artery stenosis and also atrial septal defect. Now, the maternal exposure to certain drugs, certain toxic like alcohols, are also associated with various kinds of septal defects. Usually, if the defect is minor, most of the congenital heart diseases manifest with symptoms in the childhood. But if the symptoms are minor, especially conditions which are acyanotic, they pass unrecognized during the childhood period. And when the child grows into an adult and they are accidentally diagnosed, and most of the cases are managed or without any symptoms, without any normal compromise in the quality of life, so it doesn't matter. Especially the defects which are well tolerated are atrial septal defects. They mostly cause no symptom until adult life, or first detected, like I told, accidentally on routine examination or a chest radiograph. Genetic and chromosomal abnormalities like Down syndrome cause septal defects, and gene defects causing Marfan syndrome. So these Marfan syndrome and Down syndrome, children are mostly screened for any associated congenital heart diseases in them. Now coming to the classification. This is a very important topic. You have to understand, have a thorough understanding regarding the classification of congenital heart disease. Actually, there are various classes of typing is based on various aspects. It can either be cyanotic or acyanotic, depending on the oxygen saturation of the blood. Acyanotic heart disease also can again be of either the diseases with increased pulmonary blood flow. So in diseases with increased pulmonary blood flow, the blood mostly flows between the heart and the lungs. So from both chambers, more blood will be pumped into the pulmonary artery and into the lungs. And this may not get into the systemic circulation. So even in case of acyanotic heart diseases, there can be conditions in which the pulmonary blood flow is increased. For example, in atrial septal defects, in ventricular septal defects, and also in PDA or patent ductus arteriosus, there will be circulating blood between the heart and the lungs with an increased pulmonary blood flow. And there are conditions in which there will be obstruction to the blood flow out, that outflow obstruction, what we call the outflow obstructions from the ventricle. It can either be due to some blockage in pulmonary artery or aorta. So there are various obstructing lesions that lead to the outflow obstruction from the ventricle. For example, coaptation of aorta, aortic stenosis, and pulmonary stenosis. So in cases of valvular stenosis and also the constriction of the concerned arteries, there will be outflow obstruction. So acyanotic CHDs, that is congenital heart disease, where there is no cyanosis. So what do you mean by there is no cyanosis? In acyanotic diseases, there is no mixing of, no major mixing of venous blood into the systemic circulation. In acyanotic congenital heart diseases, it can either be because of the circulating blood between the heart and the lungs with an increased pulmonary blood flow. For example, atrial septal defect, we'll understand more about the diseases, so I'm not getting into that. Ventricular septal defect and what we call ASD, BSD, and PDA are examples of acyanotic heart diseases with increased pulmonary blood flow, whereas obstructive lesions which obstruct the ventricular outflow of blood, examples, coaptation of aorta, aortic stenosis, and pulmonary stenosis. Now, coming to the next group, cyanotic heart disease, where there is a considerable mixing of venous blood into the arterial blood in the systemic circulation. So these cyanotic heart diseases can either be decreased pulmonary blood flow or with mixed blood flow. Either there will be blood not going into the lungs through pulmonary, basically there will be lack of oxygenation of blood in the lungs. So the systemic blood that reaches the right chamber will not get oxygenated, and as a result there will be decreased there will be cyanosis, and oxygen saturation will be much less. Example of cyanotic heart diseases with decreased pulmonary blood flow are tetralogy of Fallot and tricuspid atresia. In both these conditions, In tricuspid atresia, again, it is obstruction of outflow into the pulmonary artery. Whereas in tetralogy of Fallot, there are four major anatomical defects that makes the blood circulate within the heart itself, not getting into the lungs, and these mixed blood goes into systemic circulation without getting oxygenated. And there are also in certain conditions like TGA or transposition of great arteries, truncus arteriosus, and hypoplastic left heart disease, etc., there will be a mixing of blood in the heart where the oxygenated and deoxygenated blood mixes thoroughly and gets into the systemic circulation. So cyanotic heart diseases, the cyanosis can either be because of the blood not flowing into the lungs to get oxygenated, or because the oxygenated blood get mixed in the heart with the deoxygenated blood. So examples of cyanotic diseases where there is less pulmonary outflow are tetralogy of Fallot and tricuspid atresia, whereas there is mixing of pure and impure blood or oxygenated and deoxygenated blood happens in transposition of great arteries, truncus arteriosus, and in hypoplastic left heart disease. Now, diagnosis. How to diagnose a patient with heart disease? So when the child presents with the symptoms, like I said earlier, this can mimic many of the symptoms the patient present may mimic with respiratory diseases, and the symptoms like palpation, shortness of breath, etc., will also be seen in respiratory conditions as well. So to differentially diagnose congenital heart disease, you have to follow NADAS criteria. And NADAS criteria has four major criteria and five minor criteria as listed in the slide. So to diagnose a patient assertively to have a congenital heart disease, better to go for the NADAS criteria. And if you're seeing that there is at least one major criteria among the symptomatology of the patient, then you can diagnose the child to have CHD, or minimum two minor criteria among the five listed minor criteria is positive in the patient, you can diagnose the patient to have congenital heart disease. So the major criteria listed in NADAS criteria are: one, systolic murmur, especially the systolic murmur above grade 3, that is, in systolic murmur above grade 3, along with the murmur when you auscultate the child, we can also see the thrill. So the first of NADAS criteria is grade 3 and above systolic murmur, or murmur with thrill. Second is diastolic murmur. Any kind of diastolic murmur is diagnosed to be congenital heart disease. Okay. If the systolic murmur less than grade 3, if there is no thrill, you can't very specifically say that it is CHD, but above the grade of 3 with a thrill is certainly to be diagnosed, and any kind of diastolic murmur is to be diagnosed as congenital heart disease. Next important thing is presence of cyanosis. We know that if there is more than 5% of carbon dioxide in the blood, there will be cyanosis. So if the child is cyanotic, irrespective of other criteria, definitely the child has to be diagnosed having congenital heart disease. Now, congested heart failure, CCF or CHF. If the patient is having CHF, definitely, then there has to be a diagnosis, immediate diagnosis of congenital heart disease. Among the minor criteria, we say that we talked about systolic murmur from grade 3 above, single-handedly present, we have to diagnose. But in murmurs less than grade 3, that is either grade 1 or grade 2, we have to look for some other symptoms of CHDs or in the minor or major criteria to diagnose it as CHD. Abnormal S2. The second sound has to be abnormal. It has to be either split or there has to be a murmur. So abnormality in second heart sound is also one minor criteria. You have to remember that just one minor criteria alone will not contribute to the diagnosis. There has to be minimum two of minor criteria. So second among the minor criteria is abnormal second sound. Then the ECG has to be abnormal. Abnormal chest X-ray or the blood pressure, the BP of the patient has to be normal. So if any two of the five criteria turn to be positive, you can diagnose the patient to be having CHD. So this was an overview, a general idea regarding the etiology, incidence, and also the basic concepts, the overview. And we have also seen how to diagnose a patient with CHD. Now coming into individual congenital heart diseases, the first one is atrial septal defects. Just recollect the structure of the heart. Atrial septal defect is, there is a defect in interatrial septum. When the septum between the two atria has a defect or a hole permitting the shunting of blood through the wall is called atrial septal defect or ASD. So ASD or atrial septal defect is a defect in the septum separating the left and the right atria. Of all congenital heart diseases, 5 to 10% accounts for ASD. Here, we have been telling that generally speaking, congenital heart diseases don't discriminate genders, isn't it? But here in ASD, girls are more prone to ASD than boys. So in a ratio 2:1, girls are twice prone to ASD than boys. Okay, now depending on the position of the defect, we know that ASD means there is a defect in the interatrial septum. So depending on the position of the defect on the septum separating both atria, ASD can be divided into three. One is ostium secundum, ostium primum, and sinus venosus. Let's go into the detail. Ostium primum. In ostium primum, just a moment, please. Hello. Thanya, I am webinar lana. So, in ostium primum, the defect between the left and the right atrium is located in the lower part of the septum near the tricuspid valve. In ostium secundum, the defect is located near the center of the interatrial septum, and the ostium secundum is the most common among all the three types of ASDs. 50 to 70% of all ASDs account to ostium secundum, that is the defect is located almost at the middle of the interatrial septum. And sinus venosus is a defect which is located at the top portion of the interatrial septum near the entrance of the vena cava. Okay, so ASD can be divided into three depending on the position. From down up, it is ostium primum, where the defect is located at the lower part of the septum. Ostium secundum, which is the most common type, where the defect is at the middle part. And sinus venosus, the defect is located at the top portion or upper portion near the entrance of vena cava. I hope it is clear. There is a picture. You can see the left atrium, ventricle, right atrium, right ventricle, and just see, you can the arrow denotes an overflow. See, this is the position. It's close to the tricuspid valve and atrioventricular septum, atrioventricular division. It's the lower side. So this is called ostium primum. This is ostium secundum. Just notice the position of the defect. It's almost in the middle of the interatrial septum. And finally, sinus venosus. Just notice it is near the entrance of the superior vena cava, as shown in the picture, on the top portion of the interatrial septum. Okay. It's better if you can understand the diagram properly, so that you can just recollect. So primum is near the atrioventricular separation. In the middle, it is secundum, which is the commonest. 50 to 70% of all ASDs belong to ostium secundum, and finally, it is sinus venosus, which is located at the top portion of the interatrial septum. Now, let's come to the hemodynamics of what exactly happens in ASD or atrial septal defect. Now, you all know about the cardiac cycle, isn't it? Basically, the systemic circulation originates from the left of the heart, isn't it? The aorta originates from the left ventricle. So the left side of the heart normally maintains a higher pressure gradient than the right side. I hope all of you agree with that. So due to this higher pressure gradient in the left chambers, there will always be a shunting from left to right. There will always be a tendency for a shunting from left to right in case of a defect. Agreed? Always it flows from higher pressure area to the low pressure area, and always the left chambers maintain higher pressure gradients than the right chamber. So due to the increased pressure, there is a left to right shunting of oxygenated blood. Remember, there will be shunting of oxygenated blood from left to right. In a large defect, this can cause an enlargement of the right atrium, right ventricle, and also the pulmonary artery, resulting in arrhythmias. Understandable, isn't it? The rhythm of the heart depends on the filling and emptying of the blood, isn't it? So when the defect is large, there will be a large amount of overflow of blood from the left chamber to the right chamber. To accommodate this increased volume, there will be an enlargement of the right atria first. From the right atria, this increased volume has to pass into the right ventricle, and the outflow tract of right ventricle is the pulmonary artery, isn't it? So there has to be an enlargement of the pulmonary artery, which is the outlet of right ventricle. So all these areas will have hypertrophy or an enlargement. Okay. So in atrial septal defects, When the defect is large, it can cause enlarged right atria, right atrium, right ventricle, and also the pulmonary artery. So this will result in a change of the normal rhythm of the heart. If the defect is large and if it is left untreated in adult life, this can cause a congestive heart failure. In course of time, this will lead to the heart muscle failure, leading to a CHF. Now, the symptoms of atrial septal defects. A child will come with a slender build. While most of the oxygenated blood from the left side, from the left atria, passes to the right atrium. So as a result, there will be lack of systemic blood circulation, resulting in slender build for the child. You remember I was talking to you regarding differential diagnosis. Slender build, many a parents come to the OPD complaining that my child is not gaining weight, isn't it? So you will have to understand the causes behind the slender build and rule out the presence of ASD here. Okay. Now, like I told you, there will be an increased blood flow from left side to the right side, and the whole rhythm will be affected. And again, because of the forceful excess flow of, or the additional flow of the blood from left to right through the defect, there will be murmurs. Basically, there will be the excessive volume of blood which is collected from the atria, from the right atrium to the right ventricle, and there will be an increased pool of blood in the right ventricle. So this increased blood volume has to be thrown into the pulmonary artery. As a result, there will be a gushing of blood through the pulmonary valve. This will result in a cardiac murmur at the pulmonary valve. So you have to remember, at the pulmonary outflow tract, there will be a murmur heard in ASD. Usually, there is no significant exercise restriction in the children unless the defect is large. Large amount of blood, if it is shunting, definitely there has to be considerable oxygen insufficiency. So otherwise, there will not be any restriction to doing activities or exercises. Shortness of breath or palpitations are seen in certain children. So the symptoms, what are the symptoms? The child will be of slender build, may not be too much tiredness during exercise, but in certain condition, shortness of breath can be seen, and when auscultated, you can hear the murmur at the pulmonary valve. Now the pathophysiology, the hemodynamics, just remember the cardiac cycle. Physiologically, the atrial septal defect results in an excessive leakage of oxygenated blood from the left chamber to the right chamber at a minor pressure difference between two atria. There is no large pressure difference between right and left atria. So normally, if there is a small defect, there will be a leakage of oxygenated blood from left atrium to the right atrium. Now, this left to right shunt is mostly silent. The pressure gradient is not very remarkable. So normally it is very silent. We can't detect it on auscultation. When the right atrium receives blood, not only through the two vena cavae, but also through the defects or the ASD. Now the right atrium enlarges in size to accommodate this extra volume of blood. We told in the previous slide also. So the blood passes through a normal sized tricuspid valve from the atria to the ventricle, producing a delayed diastolic murmur. Okay, this delayed diastolic murmur, the diastole is delayed because there will be an excessive volume of blood collected in the atria, which has to be flown into the ventricle. So the diastole will be delayed, and this excessive volume of blood passing through a normal sized tricuspid valve from the atrium to the ventricle will result in a delayed diastolic murmur, which is audible on the backside at the left sternal border. So in ASD, the defect is very large, it is very feebly heard, and it is directly proportional to the size of the defect. But you can understand that in ASD, because of an increased blood flow through the normal size tricuspid valve, diastole will be delayed, and at the left sternal border, you can hear a delayed diastolic murmur. Hope it is clear. Now, the right ventricle also, the entire pool of blood has to be collected in the right ventricle. So it enlarges in size to accommodate the large volume reaching into it. Because of the large volume of blood passing across the normal pulmonary valve, a pulmonary ejection murmur is produced, and also a prolonged ejection phase of the right ventricle. All this blood has to be flown out into the lungs, isn't it? And the pulmonary valve is of the normal size. So this excessive blood has to go out through the normal sized pulmonary valve, and it takes a longer time, and also it creates an ejection murmur because of the increased pressure. Okay, so the second murmur now is heard where? At the pulmonary valve, as a pulmonary ejection murmur. Okay, and the ejection phase will be prolonged. Now the pulmonary valve closes a little later, because all the blood has to flow, doesn't it? So there will be a delay in the closure of pulmonary valve. What is the result? P2 will be delayed. Since P2 is delayed, the second sound will be widely split and fixed. Okay? So in case of ASD, at the left sternal border, we can hear a murmur, and also there will be a pulmonary delayed diastolic murmur and pulmonary ejection murmur can be heard, and the second sound is delayed, widely split and fixed. Hope it is clear. Now the cardiac apex is formed by the enlarged right ventricle, and the accentuated P2 is well audible at the apex. Okay, so in ASD, especially when the defect is in moderate size, there will be a slight accentuated P2, which is audible at the apex, which is formed from the enlarged right ventricle. There will be slight shift, and also there will be accentuated P2 heard at the apex. Now the pulmonary artery and its branches has to get enlarged to accommodate the large volume of blood, isn't it? So the pulmonary artery enlarges to accommodate the shunt, the blood that is coming from the shunt, and as a result there will be increased vasculation of the lung, appearing as pulmonary plethora. Okay, so in chest x-ray you can see that the lung fields will appear plethoric because of the excessive pulmonary blood flow. Hope it is clear. So there will be normally the left to right shunt, through the gap the shunt will be silent because there is no much pressure gradients between the two atria. Where does the murmur happens? When the blood passes through normal tricuspid valve from the atrium to the ventricle, since the volume of blood is more, the diastole will be delayed, and through the normal sized valve when it passes, there will be a murmur. So there will be a delayed diastolic murmur where at the left sternal border. Now, second, pulmonary. You can just imagine, the sequence of events make it very, very clear for you to understand it. Now, the pulmonary ejection murmur is heard because large volume of blood is passing through the normal sized pulmonary valve. Then, because of a delay in the closure of the valve, P2 will be delayed and the heart sound, the second heart sound will be widely split because of a delay in the P2, and also it will be fixed. Now, the cardiac apex is formed by the enlarged right ventricle, isn't it? So, an accentuated P2 will be heard at the apex of the heart. Finally, a chest X-ray when examined will show pulmonary lithora. Now, the asymptomatic condition, if the symptom, if the defect is minor, there is absolutely no problem. But in large defects, normally when the right ventricular output and pulmonary blood flow keep on increasing, isn't it? This will, in course of time, because of the overload in the pulmonary artery, there will be, over a period of time, there will be a increased pulmonary blood pressure. Okay, this pulmonary hypertension, when it gets very high, what will it happen? The chamber associated with pulmonary blood flow is right chamber, isn't it? So there will be a reversal of pressure gradient between the right and the left chambers. So when right ventricular output flow increases over a period of time, there will be increased pulmonary blood flow will result in a gradual increase in pulmonary blood pressure, which correspondingly increase the pressure gradients of the right ventricle. As a result, when the pulmonary hypertension gets excessive, the flow through the shunt through the defect will change the direction. So now, till now, it was from the oxygenated blood from the left chamber going or mixing into the deoxygenated blood and going into the lungs. There is no cyanosis, isn't it? Because there is no systemic entry of deoxygenated blood. But when the shunt reverses due to increased pulmonary blood flow and increased pulmonary hypertension, over a period of time, there will be reversal of shunt and there will be mixing of deoxygenated blood with the oxygenated blood in the left atrium, passing on to left ventricle and getting into the systemic circulation. What is the result? There will be a cyanosis, or there will be decreased oxygen saturation. And this condition of reverse shunt in all CHDs, where there is left to right shunt over a period of time, because of the increased pulmonary hypertension, the reversal of shunt occurs, and this phenomenon is known as Eisenmenger's syndrome. Eisenmenger's syndrome is a serious it's an alarming condition which can come out from an apparently harmless condition of shunt from left to right. Okay. So in all CHDs, over a period of time, when the pulmonary hypertension increases, there will be a reversal of shunt leading to Eisenmenger's syndrome. Clinical features, usually asymptomatic in early life. Increased tendency for, these are the symptoms of ASDs. Early life, there will not be any symptom. Like I told you, the children are more prone to respiratory tract infections. There will be prominent right ventricular pulsation, visible and palpable over the pericardium. Okay, so we were talking about thrill, isn't it? So there will be right ventricular pulsation, audible through auscultation definitely, and in many condition visible and palpable. the wide and fixed split of the second sound because of the delayed diastole. Now, the murmurs heard are loud ejection systolic murmur, which is located parasternally over the second and third intercostal space due to the increased blood flow through the normal sized pulmonary valve, and soft mid diastolic murmur over the apex or over the xiphoid due to the increased blood flow across the tricuspid valve. So when excessive blood flows from right atrium to right ventricle over the tricuspid valve, soft mid diastolic murmur can be heard, and a loud ejection systolic murmur when is heard at the point of outflow from the right ventricle. Okay, this is heard between second and third intercostal space. Various arrhythmias, pulmonary hypertension, Eisenmenger syndrome, and cardiac failure are the late manifestations. And cyanosis and clubbing appears when reversal of shunt occurs. Once the reversal of shunt occurs, there will be symptoms slowly setting in, like a cyanotic heart disease. Now the investigations: electrocardiogram, there will be right ventricular hypertrophy, right axis deviation because of the enlargement, especially in ostium secundum, left axis deviation in ostium primum because of the location of the defect, and in echo you can very clearly understand right ventricular dilatation and the hypertrophy, and pulmonary artery dilatation can be easily found in echo, and Doppler will make it clear that there are abnormal flow patterns through the shunt, through the defect. Chest X-ray, enlargement of right atrium and right ventricle, and increased pulmonary vascularity is known as pulmonary plethora. You can see. Treatments. Modern management goes into the line of antibiotics because recurrent respiratory infections will be there, which are managed by antibiotics. Small defect, nothing to be done, observe. Significant left to right shunting, no other option. Surgical closure. Operation surgery is contraindicated when there is severe pulmonary hypertension and reversal of shunt. If there is reversal of shunt, like when there is Eisenmenger syndrome, surgical procedure is contraindicated. So as long as the defect is minor, you just need to maintain the oxygen saturation and also take care to prevent repeated infection. This is where we can manage with immune enhancement drugs. Like in many other conditions, we can prevent through breathing exercises, not very strenuous, very mild only. And also like to increase the immunity by giving medicines like a lot of medicines are now there. Normally we here we give Indugandham Kashaya, Kadha. When the tablets are available, we can mix it with honey and give the children. And also blue tea is very effective. Whatever immune enhancement medicines which we normally give in managing all upper respiratory infections and general respiratory infection control can be done to keep the infections in check. At a very small age when it is diagnosed, normally we give certain rasayanas, and also Prabhakara Vadi is given in many conditions where surgery is not done, when the patient is just under observation, we can give a slight Brahmana Chikitsas. Various yushas can be given, and also like therapies for increasing the immunity can also be continuously given in such conditions. There are a few physicians who give Kanmada Rasayana effectively to manage the ASD in early stages. Now comes the ventricular septal defect, which is the most common. It is the like atrial septal defect. This is the defect in the septum separating the right and the left ventricles. Most common type of all, 21% of all cases contribute to VSD. VSD can either occur singularly or in multiples. More than one defect across the septum can be seen. Small defects often close spontaneously, naturally on its own in the first 2 years of life, while large defects require surgical repair within the first year. Mostly, 99% of the defect lies in the membranous portion of the ventricular septum. Very few of them are seen in the muscular portion of the septum. Prevalence is equally between boys and girls. In atrial septal, we say that girls are double prone. Here, the prevalence is equal due to increase the pressure in the left ventricle. Left to right shunting of oxygenated blood occurs. With the increased pulmonary blood flow, pulmonary hypertension can occur with large defects. You can see the defect. So this is a normal heart. This is defect in the membranous part, resulting in oxygenated blood mixing with the venous blood. This is the defect. So that mixed blood gets into the pulmonary artery. This is a symbolic representation. This is the defect. You can see that oxygenated blood circulates again between the heart and the lungs, isn't it? Now coming to the type of VSD. It can be type 1. Only less than 5% is classified as type 1. It is mostly subarterial, either near the outlet or subpulmonic, supracrystal area or infundibular area. Only very few cases come under type 1. Type 2 is the most common. It is subaortic, just beneath the aorta. Most of them are like that. It's called type 2. 75 to 80% of the defect located at the perimembranous subaortic area called type 2. Type 3, only 9% in the inlet canal, in inlet area at the atrioventricular canal. Type 4, 10% in the trabecular muscular part. It can either be anterior marginal type or Swiss cheese type. It looks like, you know, the muscular portion with the small holes will give the appearance of a Swiss cheese. So depending on the anatomical location, VSD can be of 4 types. It can be type 1, type 2, type 3, or type 4. Subarterial is type 1, perimembranous type 2, near the atrioventricular canal is the type 3, and at the muscular portion of the membrane of the septum, it is type 4. So the management also depends on the anatomical location. This is the typical look, various types. Posterior AVA canal, the first, perimembranous, the muscular portion, number 3, the multiple defects in the muscular portion, you can see, and 6 is supracrystal. Yeah, this is apical muscular and multiple roots. So it gives a cheesy appearance, isn't it? The ventricular septal defect, another schematic view. Now, the symptoms of VSDs: rapid breathing, irritability, excessive sweating, poor weight gain. Poor weight gain is associated with almost all CHDs. congestive heart failure, usually within 6 to 8 weeks of life if the defect is large. This is the point to be noted. CHF sets in a very early stage if the defect is large. Now, the eventual development of pulmonary hypertension is there if the defect is large. So these are the symptoms seen in ventricular septal defect. There will be rapid breathing. Child will be highly irritable. There will be excessive sweating. Child will have poor weight gain. Then CHF in very early stages of life, as early as 6 to 8 weeks in large defects, and also there will be reversal of shunt and development of pulmonary hypertension in case of large defects. Pathophysiology, since we have seen the pathophysiology in ASD, I think it's easier for you to grasp it this time. I'll just fastly go through it. There will be shunting of oxygenated blood from the left chamber to the right. The pressure gradients is always like that in between the left and the right, isn't it? So there will be shunting of oxygenated blood from the left chamber to the right. The left ventricle starts contracting before the right ventricle, isn't it? The flow of the blood from the left ventricle to the right ventricle starts very early in a systole, and a high pressure gradient is normally maintained between the two ventricles throughout the system. Okay. So the flow of blood from the left ventricle to the right ventricle with that pressure difference continuous throughout the system. Now the murmur resulting from the left to right shunt starts early with the systole, making the first sound, and the continuous systole will always have this flow through the shunt maintained. Okay, so as a result, the murmur resulting from the shunt of the blood through the defect starts early with the early systole of the left chamber, and it continues throughout the systole, appearing as a pan-systolic murmur on auscultation, and this will be in all palpation appear as a palpable thrill. Okay, so apart from the pan-systolic murmur that goes parallel with the entire systole, almost completely masking the first sound. Apart from this pan-systolic murmur masking the first sound, you can palpate a thrill also in the left intercostal space. So towards the end of the systole, there will be a decrease in the pressure of the left ventricle. Then this left ventricular pressure will be less than the aortic pressure. So there will be the closure of aortic valve and the occurrence of A2. So the left ventricular pressure is still higher than the right ventricular pressure compared to the aorta. Aorta will have a higher pressure. So there will be the closure of the A2, the aortic valve, and the occurrence of the A2. But the right side, the right ventricular pressure is still lower than that of the left side. So there will be a left to right shunt maintained throughout the systole, continuing the pan-systolic murmur, masking the second sound also. Okay. So even when the aortic pressure is larger than the left ventricular pressure and the aortic valve closes, since the pressure gradients is still maintained between the left and the right ventricles, there will be the shunting of blood from the left ventricle to the right ventricle throughout the systole, continuing this pan-systolic murmur, masking the second sound also. Okay? So this left to right ventricular shunt occurs during the systole at a time when the right ventricle is also contracting and its volume is decreasing, isn't it? So when the left to right shunt is continuing, right ventricle also goes into the systole and the right ventricular volume keeps on decreasing. So there will be an increased flow of blood across the normal pulmonary valve resulting in ejection systolic murmur. So this excessive volume that comes into the right ventricle during the systole from the left ventricle all has to go out through the normal sized pulmonary valve, isn't it? So this large volume of blood passing through the lungs will be seen as pulmonary lymphoma. Okay, so since there is excessive blood flow through the pulmonary artery through the normal sized pulmonary valve, there will be ejection systolic murmur. Since there is an excessive blood flow into the lungs, there will be pulmonary lymphoma. Since the increased blood volume finally reaches the left atrium from the lungs, there will be left atrial enlargement also. Passing through a normal mitral valve, the large volume of blood reaching the left atrium takes more time to empty into the ventricle, resulting in delayed diastole, and delayed diastolic murmur is heard when this excessive volume from the lung enters the atria and empties into the ventricle. There will be delayed diastolic murmur at the apex. Is it clear? Because finally, the increased blood flow going into the lungs will reach the left atrium. From the left atrium, it passes through a normal mitral valve into the left ventricle, and there will be left atrial enlargements. There will be delay in the diastole, and since because of this excessive blood flow, there will be diastolic murmur also. As a result, there will be, what are the findings? There will be ejection systolic murmur, there will be pulmonary plethora, enlargement of left atrium visible in the x-ray, and also on auscultation there will be delayed diastolic murmur. The intensity and duration of the delayed diastolic murmur depends directly on the size of the shunt. More the blood, more the delay. The left ventricle has two outlets: the systemic circulation through aorta and also through the shunt, isn't it? The left ventricle has two outlets: the aortic valve allowing the forward flow into the systemic circulation, and the ventricular septal defect resulting in a backwardly getting into the lungs again, isn't it? So a large amount of blood which has to go to the systemic circulation re-enters the lungs, isn't it? So as a result, the left ventricle empties relatively early. Okay, so the systole will be of shorter duration. This will result in an early atrium because only very less amount of blood only goes into the systemic circulation, and large volume of blood is passing into the right ventricle from the left ventricle, isn't it? So aorta closes early. As a result, there will be an early A2 heard, and since the ejection into the right ventricle and pulmonary artery is increased because large amount of blood is flowing into the right atrium from the right ventricle from the left ventricle, isn't it? So as a result, P2 will be delayed because there is more volume to go into the pulmonary artery than the aorta. So aorta closes early and pulmonary valve closes late. As a result, P2 is delayed. Second sound will be widely split, but varies with the respiration in patients of VSD with large left to right shunt. Okay, it's very easy to understand if you just remember the cardiac cycle. Since systemic circulation, the less blood is available for systemic circulation, aortic closure will be early. Since there are increased volume of blood to pass through the pulmonary valve, the closure of pulmonary valve will be delayed. As a result, second sound will be widely split. Again, Eisenmenger syndrome, we were talking about ASD. Over a period of time, there will be reversal of shunt because increased pulmonary blood flow will increase the pulmonary hypertension. So the right chamber will have higher pressure gradient than the left chamber, and reversal of shunt occurs. Clinical features: patients with VSD can become symptomatic around 6 to 10 weeks of age. Palpitation, dyspnea on exertion, and frequent chest infection are the main symptoms in older children. Very important. This mimics with respiratory diseases also. On examination, pulse pressure will be relatively wide. Precordium is hyperkinetic with systolic thrill at the left sternal border. Cardiac size will be moderately enlarged. First and second heart sound are masked by the pan systolic murmur. Okay, because the entire systole, the flow through the defect is maintained. As a result, the first and second heart sounds are masked by a pan systolic murmur. Investigations: ECG, depending upon the size of the defect, it may show left ventricular hypertrophy or biventricular hypertrophy. Now, echocardiography shows enlargement of both right and left ventricle as well as the left atrium, since excessive flow is there into the pulmonary artery. Now, the Doppler echocardiography will show the abnormal flow pattern and the site of the defect. Chest X-ray, cardiomegaly, because three chambers are getting enlarged, isn't it? Pulmonary plethora, understandable. Enlargement of main pulmonary artery to accommodate the excessive pulmonary outflow and large hilar arteries. So this is a condition where the pulmonary blood flow is enormously increased, so the symptoms are accordingly. So the chest X-ray typically is shown in the picture. Assessment of severity. Again, VSD is a condition where small can be ignored, but large VSD cannot be ignored, and it has to be surgically repaired in comparison with ASD. The left to right shunt murmur continues to be pan-systolic. If the shunt is small, the second sound is normally split and the intensity of P2 is normal. Even though the shunt is small, even though it is split, the intensity will be normal. Absence of delay in diastolic mitral murmur, because if the volume is large, then only there will be considerable delay in passing of blood from left atrium to left ventricle. So as a result, if the VSD is very small, there will not be much delay in mitral murmur, diastolic mitral murmur. The VSD is very small, it acts as a stenotic area, resulting in an ejection systolic murmur, also known as functional systolic murmur in children, which disappears as they grow up because of the spontaneous closure of the small VSD. If it is very small, because of the during the systole, there will be a forceful ejection through the very small defect. There will be a small ejection systolic murmur, which is also known as a functional systolic murmur, which disappears once the defect is spontaneously closed. The first 2 years, normally, this will be spontaneously closed. In large VSDs, it results in the transmission of left ventricular systolic pressure to the right ventricle, and right ventricular pressure increases, and the difference in the systolic pressure of the two ventricles decreases. Left to right shunt murmur becomes shorter and softer, and on the bedside it appears as an ejection systolic murmur. Since the pressure difference goes less, the intensity of the murmur and also the duration of the murmur becomes less. If there is right ventricular outflow obstruction due to pulmonary stenosis, the large ventricular pressure increases and the VSD murmur becomes ejection systolic murmur. In many cases, like I told you, VSD is seen alone and also in combination with many other cardiac defects. So if the large VSD is coupled with a pulmonary stenosis, there will be obstruction for the blood flow from the right ventricle, and the right ventricular pressure increases, and the murmur resulting from VSD will be an ejection systolic murmur. Medical management is to basically control the congestive cardiac failure. Now, the treatment of repeated chest infection, prevention and treatment of anemia and infective endocarditis are the priorities in the medical management of VSD. The surgical management is ventriculotomy. The indications: one, congestive cardiac failure occurs in infancy period, and if it is not responding to medical management, then the first year itself we have to refer the patient for surgery. Then if the left to right shunt is large, definitely surgical management is indicated. And if there is a pulmonary stenosis and outflow obstruction to the pulmonary flow, then definitely there will be pulmonary hypertension, or there will be complication of aortic regurgitation also, which also needs an immediate repair. Modern management, Lasix and Aldactone is normally given as a medical management to prevent or decrease the symptoms of heart failure. Digoxin is given to increase the effectiveness of myocardial function. We can also give drugs which can enhance the cardiac musculature. If surgery is needed, patching or suturing the defect can be done. Normally, the surgical management of VSD is widely done. Very high success rate is reported. Mortality is very, very low. Now comes patent ductus arteriosus. It's a very large topic, CHD. You may be requiring a break. I hope I can continue.
Can continue, madam.
Dr. Hiremat, is there a requirement of break or anything? Because, you know, what do you think? Can I continue?
Madam, continue. Madam.
Okay. I'll try to make it brief. Next is patent ductus arteriosus, which is a very commonly known condition. Just remember the fetal circulation. I'm not getting into the details of fetal circulation or anything. Just remember ductus arteriosus. Ductus arteriosus. Just, you all know that during fetal life, fetal lung doesn't function, isn't it? We must have learned about resuscitation of the child, the spontaneous respiration, isn't it? Surfactant, respiratory distress syndrome. Just recollect all these things. Okay. Now come to ductus arteriosus. Ductus arteriosus is a bypass between the two large vessels, aorta and pulmonary artery. So ductus arteriosus in infant life mixes the systemic blood with the pulmonary blood. Okay, that much only I am mentioning right now. So the ductus arteriosus connects the pulmonary artery to the descending aorta during the fetal life. The patent ductus arteriosus results when this ductus arteriosus fails to close after the birth. Normally with the first cry, once the lungs start functioning, slowly the ductus arteriosus closes. So in infant life, after the birth, if it fails to close, then PDA or patent ductus arteriosus results. I'm not getting into fetal circulation. Symptoms of PDA or patent ductus arteriosus: children with small PDA are usually asymptomatic. Large left to right shunts develop symptoms of congestive heart failure, such as tachypnea, tachycardia, overfeeding, and slow growth. So remember, in large or significant PDA, there will be tachypnea, tachycardia, overfeeding, slow growth, and if left untreated, can lead to CCF. Physical examination: continuous murmur is heard best at the left sternal border. This is a condition of PDA. You can see here the patency, which mixes the pulmonary blood with the aortic blood. This is another picture. Now the pathophysiology: PDA results in a left to right shunt from the aorta to the pulmonary artery. Why? Pressure gradients of aorta is always higher. So from aorta, blood shunts into the pulmonary artery. The flow occurs both during systole and the diastole, as the pressure gradient is always present throughout the cardiac circle between the two great arteries. So flow of blood results in a murmur which starts in the systole after the first sound, and it reaches a peak at the second sound and then diminishes in intensity and is audible only feebly through a part of the system. So it is a continuous murmur which starts immediately after the systole, persists throughout, but it reaches its peak after the first sound. Okay, so the murmur starts during the systole after the first sound and reaches the peak at the second sound, then diminishes in intensity, and only through a part of the diastole this murmur is audible. So by the late part of the diastole, the shunting will be closed. So it's almost a continuous murmur with varying intensity. It starts after the systole, reaches at its peak at the second sound, and then diminishes. PDA results in a systolic as well as diastolic overloading of the pulmonary artery. Always the pressure gradient is maintained and always blood flows from aorta to the pulmonary artery. The increased flow after passing through the lungs reaches the left atrium. So whenever there is increase in pulmonary blood flow, the left atrium is overloaded. To accommodate the flow, the left atrium enlarges. The increased volume of blood reaching the left atrium has to go down into the left ventricle during diastole across the normal mitral valve. The increased flow across the mitral valve results in the accentuated first sound as well as the delay in diastolic murmur. Since there is an increased blood flow through the mitral valve and there is large volume of blood through the mitral valve, the sound will be accentuated and it will be delayed. Time will be taken to complete the entire blood to empty into the ventricle. So there will be delay in diastole. So the delayed diastolic murmur and accentuation of the first sound is heard during diastole. Okay. Now in small shunts, there will be no mitral diastolic murmur. We have stated earlier also that towards the end of the diastole, almost the shunting will be it will be fading down. So in small shunts, there will be no mitral diastolic murmur. Moderate size shunts, left ventricular third sound is audible due to a rapid filling of the ventricle. If the considerable size refer to considerable amount of overloading of left atrium, in that condition the left ventricular third sound will be audible due to the rapid filling of the ventricle. In large shunts, mitral delayed diastolic murmur will be there. The left ventricle will be receiving an increased volume of blood flow during the diastole from the enlarged atria. It causes a diastolic overloading of the left ventricle and causes a prolongation of the left ventricular systole. Since there is a large number of pooling of blood in the left ventricle after the diastole, there will be a prolongation of the systole to pull out all this, to push out all this excess blood, isn't it? So there will be a prolongation of the left ventricular systole and an increase in the size of the left ventricle to accommodate this extra volume. So this prolonged ventricular systole results in a delayed closure of the aortic valve. You have to wait till the entire blood is emptied into the systemic circulation, and also that much delay will be there in the closure of the aortic valve, and late A2 will be heard. So a prolonged systole with a delayed A2 will be heard in PDA, in large PDA. Now the large left ventricular volume ejected into the aorta results in the dilatation of the ascending aorta. The ascending aorta has to accommodate the increased forceful pulling of the excessive blood, so there will be an enlargement of the or the dilatation of the ascending aorta, which produces an aortic ejection click, which is audible all over the precordium, and it precedes the start of the continuous murmur. It precedes because, you know, once the aorta is full with blood, then only the ejection starts from the aorta into the pulmonary artery, isn't it? So before the murmur is heard, there will be a aortic ejection click heard. The large volume of blood from the left ventricle passing through a normal aortic valve result in an aortic ejection systolic murmur. So the large volume, there will be an increase in volume and also an increase in pressure. So this will give an aortic ejection systolic murmur during the left ventricular system. Again, same condition we have been telling, over a period of time, since the pulmonary blood flow is increasing, there will be eventual increase in pressure gradients of the right side. So there will automatically a reversal shunt happening in course of time, leading to Eisenmenger's syndrome. Clinical features: no symptoms until left ventricular failure comes. Pulse pressure is wide with a low diastolic pressure. Apex beat will be shifted. It will be down and out. It will be down and more lateral due to the left ventricular overload. There will be considerable hypertrophy of the left ventricle, and as a result, the apex beat position will be shifted down and out. There will be continuous murmur. Thrill may be palpable over the site where the murmur is heard the best. Electrocardiography and echocardiography are suggested, which the ECG will suggest normal or left ventricular hypertrophy, and echo is very useful because we can detect the leakage of blood through the patent rectus arteriosus from the ascending aorta to the pulmonary artery. Chest X-ray, a large heart shadow and large size of pulmonary artery, dilated aortic knuckle, that is another important finding. Hilar and lung vessels will be dilated. Assessment of severity depends, again, all VSD also we're telling that directly depends on the larger the size of the defect. The larger the heart size, the larger the left to right shunt. Absence of third, larger the heart size depends on the size of the patency, so that more blood flow enters the left atrium, isn't it? Absence of the third sound and delayed diastolic murmur indicates a small left to right shunt. Presence of the third sound indicates a moderate shunt. The wider the pulse, the wider the pulse pressure, the larger the shunt will be. So you have to notice the variance in the pulse pressure to estimate the size of the shunt. Treatment: indomethacin or ibuprofen can be tried in neonates. Normally this enhances the spontaneous closure of the PDA. If there is a reversal of shunt, there is no treatment. In absence of severe pulmonary hypertension, ductus can be surgically ligated or divided. The surgery should be deferred for several months if there is infective endocarditis, and since the ductus may be edematous, you have to postpone the surgery till the inflammation is. And finally, we'll talk about the tetralogy of Fallot. I'm not going into the etymology of the defect. Tetralogy indicates, the word tetra indicates the number four. It is named after the surgeon Fallot. He is the first person who has published a paper in 1888. This is the scientist, so it's named after him. There are four defects. You can see the picture. I'll point the defects. There will be large ventricular septal defects. So the VSD has to be large enough. We were talking about pulmonary stenosis coupled with ventricular septal defect while talking about VSD, isn't it? So there will be a pulmonary artery stenosis along with the large ventricular defect. Then there will be an overriding of aorta over the right and the left ventricle, especially in case of large VSD. Since the septal separation will not be there in that peri-aortal entry area, the aorta will commonly cover the both chambers of right and left ventricles. So this is known as aortic overriding of right and left ventricles. You can see. See, the aorta will push out the blood from both ventricle because of the defect in the ventricular septum. Now, finally, there will be right ventricular outflow and right to left shunt through. There will be the four, what all have we told? One, it is large ventricular septal defect. There will be considerable pulmonary stenosis, and there will be overriding of right and left chambers for the aorta so that the blood from both chambers are pulled out. And finally, there will be an enlargement of the right ventricle because of the shunt from the left ventricle. You can see the enlargement of the right ventricle. So in tetralogy of Fallot, there will be large VSD. There will be a stenosis of pulmonary artery. There will be an overriding of aorta on both chambers, and there is an enlargement, or there is a hypertrophy of the right ventricle. These are the four defects which appear together in tetralogy of Fallot. Pulmonary tetralogy of Fallot is covers almost 10% of all cardiac congestive congenital heart diseases. There will be a pulmonary stenosis, there will be a large VSD, there will be an overriding of aorta, and there will be a hypertrophy of right ventricle. Now the pathophysiology. There is large shunting of blood from the left to the right ventricle through the large VSD. There is an increased resistance to the right ventricle outflow because of the pulmonary stenosis. This causes the deoxygenated systemic venous return to be diverted from the right ventricle through the VSD to an overriding aorta, and this blood will be pulled into the systemic circulation, resulting in systemic hypoxemia and cyanosis. See, normally there is a large volume of blood passing from the left ventricle into the right ventricle. This has to completely pass through the pulmonary artery into the lungs. Now, what happens when there is a pulmonary stenosis? There will be outflow obstruction to the right ventricle. Since this obstruction is there and there is a large ventricular septal defect, what happens during the systole? The deoxygenated blood from the right chamber shunts into the aorta. It shunts through the VSD into this overriding aorta and pushes it into the systemic circulation. So this mixed blood with little oxygenated blood from the left chamber, which profusely mixed with the deoxygenated blood in the right ventricle, because of the resistance to outflow into the lungs, throws back into the aorta through the defect and overriding aorta, leading into cyanosis and systemic circulation of deoxygenated blood. This is what is happening in tetralogy of Fallot. Very simple. This will result in dyspnea on exertion or when the child is crying because of the hypoxemia. Now the TET spells, tetralogy of Fallot, cause sudden cyanotic spells known as TET spells, symptomatized by irritability, cyanosis, hyperventilation, and sometimes syncope or convulsions due to cerebral hypoxemia. So since there is severely deoxygenated blood circulating in the system, TET spells or cyanotic spells are happening in tetralogy of Fallot. Symptoms are irritability, cyanosis, hyperventilation, and even syncope or convulsions as a result of cerebral hypoxemia. Normally, when there is an increased thoracic pressure, the symptoms tend to alleviate. As a result, the patient tend to alleviate the symptom by squatting down, which increases the systemic resistance. So there is, when there is systemic resistance, lesser deoxygenated blood will be pulled into the aorta. So as a result, if you squat, the increased thoracic pressure will result in the systemic resistance and decreases the right left shunt, directing more blood into the pulmonary circulation. On physical examination, there will be clubbing of fingers and all symptoms of cyanotic diseases like clubbing of fingers and toes. There is specifically systolic ejection murmur is heard at the upper left sternal border, created by the turbulent blood flow through the stenotic right ventricle outflow tract. Since there is a remarkable pulmonary stenosis, when the blood tries to flow from the right ventricle into the pulmonary artery, there will be a systolic ejection murmur, which is heard at the right upper left sternal border because of this resistance of the pulmonary artery because of the pulmonary stenosis. Lab studies, there will be prominent right ventricle because of hypertrophy of right ventricle. There will be a prominence or hypertrophy of right ventricle seen in chest X-ray. The ECG shows right ventricular hypertrophy and right axis deviation, and the echo will show shows the extent of right ventricular outflow tract obstruction. Okay, so echo qualitatively and quantitatively give you an idea regarding how much there is obstruction to the right ventricular outflow because of the pulmonary stenosis. Treatment, surgical closure of the VSD. The large VSD has to be immediately surgically closed to stop the overriding of aorta, and there will be the pulmonary stenosis has to be removed. So there has to be an enlargement of the pulmonary outflow tract. So basically the two things has to be done are, one, surgical closure of the large VSD to prevent the overriding of aorta, and also there has to be the obstruction of the pulmonary artery has to be removed. So there has to be enlargement of the pulmonary outflow tract. Now getting into the modern management strategies. The overall incidence of sudden death in TOF patients after surgical repair is just 0.3. After the repair, there has to be precautions against endocarditis. Residual VSD secondary to the incomplete closure is a possibility, so you have to take care. There can be residual RV outflow tract obstruction. Even though the stenosis is corrected, it may not be complete. So there can be increased pulmonary resistance even after the repair. Chronic pulmonary valve regurgitation results in large volume overload on the right ventricle, which can lead to cardiomegaly and increased incidence of arrhythmias. So the right ventriculotomy during the repair leads to scarring, which increases the risk of dysarrhythmia. When the scarring is there, it affects the muscular movements of the heart, resulting in various kinds of dysarrhythmias and conduction abnormalities because of the scarring of the tissues. A typical TET spell is pictured here. So you can see the acrocyanosis. Typical boot-shaped heart is seen in tetralogy of Fallot. With this, I think we can conclude. Like I was telling you, timely diagnosis is the key. Differential diagnosis with recurrent respiratory infections and nutritional deficiencies is very important. Timely reference to a pediatric cardiologist in case of any arrhythmias or any murmurs accidentally found. Immunity enhancement to cope up with the infections. Symptomatic management in silent cases, especially in ASD, is advised. In infants and toddlers, Brahmana Chikilsa to build up and strengthen the dhatus, especially for enhancing the spontaneous closure, can be done in the first 2 years of life. Easy breathing exercises can be advised as applicable in case of shortness of breath, etc. Thank you. I know it has been an extensive session, but the topic is so vast.
Yes, ma'am.
I know that you are bored, but maybe the recording may come to you at handy times during exams.
Yes, thank you very much, madam. It was a very informative lecture, madam, on congenital heart diseases in children. Sahaja Vyadhis, you have covered both the Ayurvedic aspect as well as the modern aspect in detail with pathophysiology and the diagnosis of the same along with the treatment principles. Okay, as an Ayurvedic doctors or a pediatricians or Ayurvedic practitioners, it is needed to understand the different comorbidities and symptomatology associated with congenital heart diseases. It is very, very important in diagnosing the children's with congenital heart diseases and for the reference of, proper referral of the same. Okay, it is very much needed, and it is a very informative session, madam. Thank you very much. I request participants, if you have any queries, you can ask directly to madam. Or
I have also given my email ID. If you have like, you know, in later stage, if you want any clarification or anything, you can mail to me. Yes. So your like, you know, Dr. Hiremath or your HOD can help. Yes. I am ready to available because it has been an extensive session. I know.
Yes, ma'am. I request all the participants, if you have any queries, you can ask directly madam, or you can put your queries in chat box so that madam will clarify. Okay, madam. I think madam, I think no queries, madam.
Yeah.
Actually, in my clinical practice, I came across a patent adductus arteriosus case, madam.
Okay.
And that too not major, but that child was having some comorbidities like recurrent respiratory tract infection and all. And those measures, what you told, the immunity enhancing measures. And to boost the immunity.
Then in PDA, we can give Prabhakaravadi.
Prabhakaravadi.
Yeah, that also we give. And also, Chira Kashayas of, Urila. Urila is, I think, Mudgabarni. Is also suggested. And like a friend of mine, he treats the, especially ASD and PDA for spontaneous closure with Kanmada Rasayana.
Kanmada Rasayana, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. And also you mentioned Indukanta Kashayam also.
That is basically for immune enhancement because, most of this, even during the initial stages of my practice, I still have the entire family of that patient is now with me because this patient was having recurrent upper respiratory infection symptoms. Has been taken to so many hospitals where they have been putting him on continuous antibiotics.
Yes, madam.
So when I was auscultating, I could hear the murmur, but I couldn't exactly put into the diagnosis what exactly was that. Yes. So I was unable to diagnose it as ASD. I was not confident enough, but I could understand the murmurs.
Yes.
So I could refer him to, there is a Cherveyan Memorial Hospital here, which is specialized for cardiology. And there is one very famous, world-renowned pediatric cardiologist by Dr. Saji Cherian. So I referred the patient to Dr. Saji Cherian and he was very appreciative of us. Like an Ayurvedic physician was the one who diagnosed. The patient was about 3.5 years when he came to me with every 20 days going for an antibiotic therapy. And there was failure to thrive also. The child was very lean and irrespective of having good appetite. So such conditions are warning signs for us. And we have to have confidence in our medicine. Even after giving our medicines for controlling recurrent respiratory infections, upper and lower, if the patient is not responding, believe in ourselves, then we can say that there is something else.
Yes, madam.
There we can, that is where we need to be very, very careful.
Yes, madam. That is thorough clinical assessment is needed even.
Exactly. That is where you have to be thorough with the murmurs. Yes. And I really advise all your students I keep my students, every time I keep them advising them, you listen to the heart sounds to each other. Even if you are there, when there is no patients, go back to the hostels, listen to the respiratory sounds and listen to the cardiac sounds. At least you will be able to distinguish between normal and abnormal sounds. And whenever there is an abnormal sound, even if you are not able to pinpoint, again, YouTube videos are available. Now, a lot of videos are, because, this has been an extensive, it was only one or two CHDs, I would have shown audios as well. So listen carefully to understand the murmurs and definitely I can 100% show that we'll be able to diagnose the disease.
Yes, madam, sure that clinical analysis is very, very,
very, very
nowadays. Before referring the child to a right place.
Exactly.
Madam. Thank you very much, madam. I think
it's a real pleasure to have all of you with us.
Madam.
Thank you very much.
Madam. Thank you, madam. And I also thank all the participants for their patient listening. And madam, you have given your precious time on this lecture. And we are happy to have you on this occasion, madam. And on behalf of our institution and the Department of Comorbidity, SVM Ayurveda Medical College, Ilkal, we thank you, madam. Thank you very much. And request to all the participants. And the next lecture on Kumarabharan 2020 webinar series, that will be on 24th. Of August 2020, that is on Monday, on the topic Role of Breastfeeding in Neonates by Dr. Bharati Tiwari, Madam, Assistant Professor, Department of Comorbidity, Jeevan Jyoti Ayurveda College, Aligarh, Uttar Pradesh. And stay tuned with us on that day. I hope this session will be very informative and that will be benefited all the participant. Thank you, madam. Thank you.